Don't you guys see? Don't you realize? We have to stay. We have to learn how to use Google Maps with our Webflow sites. Look how far we've come. We've got a chance.
Chance at what, Mikey? Getting killed? Look, if we keep going, someone's really gonna get hurt. Maybe dead. Besides, we gotta get to the police.
Maybe Chunk already got to the police.
Maybe Chunk is dead.
Don't say that. Never say that. Goonies never say die.
I'm not a Goonie. I wanna go home.
Don't you realize? Anytime a client wants a map on their website, we won't know how. Anytime they need to show the location of a business, we won't know how. Our parents, they wanted the best of stuff for us, but right now they've got to do what's best for them, because it's their time up there. But down here, it's our time. It's our time down here. Our chance at mastering Webflow is all over the second we ride up Troy's bucket. You ruined it. Hey everybody, welcome back. Today I'm going to show you how to incorporate Google Maps into your Webflow sites. I thought it should be Goonies theme with treasure maps, Google Maps. See the theme here. I'll show you two ways of approaching this, one being the iFrame embed element, and then the other being the Google API key itself. So let's dive right in. So here we are in this site. It's pretty simple. It's got the nice logo here, all the little touches that represent the movie. Got the nice little cast of our guys. Goonies never say die. And just some simple kind of instructions as if they were building a website. Basic stuff. But so you see this container in here. So basically I've got a container that holds this section, and then inside of it is just a content div, and that's divided into two 50% width divs, so that way they both take up half of the parent's container. First one is the info div, that just holds all of this text, and then I have an empty div on the side here, and you'll see it's just an empty div with the width of 50% called the map div. And that's where I'm gonna store the map elements that we build out. And I'll show you why it's easier to put them inside of a div rather than just have them free floating. So let's start with the basic version first, which is the iFrame. This is the easy one that doesn't require an API. So we can just go over to Google Maps. And here we are. I just typed in Astoria, Oregon. That's where the film takes place, the Goon Docks right in Astoria. Wonderful. So if you just click this little drop-down menu, you're allowed to access some settings. So I'm gonna click Share or Embed Map. And right here, you can send a link, but I want to embed a map. So this opens up the iframe. So an iframe is an element that is allowed in HTML. So I've now copied that to my clipboard. And when I go here, I'm gonna put an item inside my map div. Just press Command K, and I can insert a new element into this field. And I'm gonna do an embed. Here we go. And now this is just a section that'll hold some custom code for us. And in here, I can just paste that iframe from Google Maps. And you'll see there, it's just got the link there. And this is not a static image. This is sort of like a live representation of the Google Maps itself. And I'll go over the pros and cons of all of this at the end. But you'll see here, it's got some basic styles, height, width, border, all that. So when I click save and close, you'll see it pulls up immediately. So it's representing a live link of the map itself in Google Maps. You'll see it's kind of just filling the space from that div that I put it in, the map div. And it has some set dimensions on it. But if I change this, I can just go to the settings. I can make the width 300. I can make the height 45. And when you see that, obviously that's hideous and you don't want that. So instead of using the set dimensions that usually come by default, what I will do is just do 100% height and 100% width. And when you click save and close, there we go. Now it's kind of waiting to be flexible, because if I were to leave the basic settings, when you scale down, it doesn't scale. So the one problem with iframe is that it's kind of just structured in a way that doesn't let you scale up and down with different content unless you build it properly. So now the height and the width is actually set to 100%. I can just make sure that the actual height and width of the embed element, not just the map inside of it,
is 100% of its parent container, and the width is also 100%. And there we go. You see how it grows to fill the space of what it's inside, which is our map div. And that is 50% width, but it's taking up automatic height, so it's filling the same amount of the other column. But say I made the map div, I don't know, 1,000 pixels. You see how the map inside of it grows to fill the space. So it allows you to have some flexibility here for sure. So as long as you have the height and width inside of this embed element set to 100%, you can just change the size in one place instead, and it'll just absorb the styling of whatever it's inside of. Another benefit to having our map div inside of a container and not just free floating as an embed element is you have some more flexibility with design. So you're a little limited when you use an iframe. If you use the API key, you have some more options in terms of what your map can look like, but there's a way to little cheat some basic things like overlays. So as long as it's inside of a container, I can take the container and just add another div there. I'll make the position absolute. And as long as I make, let's go back to our map div really quick, make this position relative so the absolute div has something to base itself on. And then when I click full, now that div we just created, I'll just name this overlay, that's living on top of the map div. Remember, the map div is already inside of that. So now I can just give this new overlay div a background. I can give it some sort of faded color. I can give it a nice gradient of some sort. I can make it maybe red to transparent. I mean, it doesn't look that great, but you get the idea. And then technically you can have this overlay. You can say on hover, its opacity goes to 0. So that way you can add some subtle interactions to make it more unique and customizable. And the only issue with this overlay is that you can no longer click what's underneath it, right? So if I go to the live view, when I hover, the opacity goes away, but technically it's still recognizing there's something on top of this map. So I can't actually click those spaces. So this doesn't always work. You might have to play around with the sizing or the Z index to stack things on top of each other. And so not always the best solution if you want something customizable and nice. But if you're just looking for something basic, iframe is definitely good. But that's the embed element. So really I just took that element that's made in Webflow, went to Google Maps, copied this iframe code and just put it there. And then I just gave it 100% height and width dimensions, so it's filling our map div container. Super simple, and it works. Okay, so let's move on to the Google Map API integration itself. So don't be afraid of API and all of this code and things that's happening here. It's really just a way to have two things talk to each other and retrieve data between different places. So an API is called an application programming interface, and it's something in the coding world and JavaScript that you can reference to kind of transmit different pieces of information between one place and another. So what we're doing here on our Webflow site is just linking the API to the Google Maps section, and then they can just absorb all the information that we're trying to pull from. So to get started with that, I'm going to use the same reference here. It's our map div, so that container element that's taking up 50% of this other container. So again, I'll press Command K, and here there's actually a map element. So I'm just going to click that, and you'll see here, Google Maps API key required. It's not going to display anything until we actually hook it up with something. So I'm going to click Add API key. That brings me into our project settings here. You'll see there's a section under integrations for this project called Google Maps. And it says here I can create a Google Maps JavaScript API key. I'm going to click that. It brings me over to Google. And just make sure you're signed into the Gmail that you want this to be associated with. So when I click Get Started, it takes me in here. And I just got to go through some basic steps. And it's not going to charge you anything, so don't worry about that. So basically how Google Maps works is that when you set it up, they're going to give you a recurring $300 credit. And I'm pretty sure you just have up to 100,000 map loads before it puts you over that credit limit. So basically every time someone visits the site and kind of uses the map, it's counting that as one map load. So unless you go over 100,000 of those in a month, you're not going to go over your credit amount and you won't have to pay anything. And I think it refreshes every month. So unless you have some really big traffic website that people are using your map and scrolling over it and interacting with it, you really shouldn't have to worry about this. So you just go through the basic steps, agree to the terms of service, and you're just going to set up your payment profile here. Just give it a name, and then you can add the different payment method and click Start My Free Trial once you're done setting that up. And it's going to welcome you in here and just ask some basic information. What's your reason for signing up? I'm here to build. And when you set that, it says you're all set to start developing. Perfect. And look, it takes us right here. We have our API key. So now enable all Google Map APIs for this project. This is the budget alert. And oh, it's 200 credit fee, not 300. It's going to alert you if you come close to going over that. But like I said, you really don't have to worry about that. You're not going to go over it. So I'm going to copy this key and I'll go back over to our Webflow project. And when I paste that in, just go up here, hit save changes. And then when I go to the designer, you'll see here how now instead of that register an API key, it has the generic map preview. So all you need to do is publish this to view this. So I'll just publish it to our custom Webflow domain. And then when we go to our live site here, you'll see now we have an actual map. Amazing. And right now it just kind of goes to default location in London. Not sure why that is, but wonderful. We don't want London. So when we go back to our project, all we have to do is click on our map element, go to the settings, and it just says address. All we have to do is put an address in. So I'm going to type Astoria, Oregon. Click enter. It should figure it out. There it goes. And you can go to the all settings here on the right. And we typed in our address already. You can add a tooltip if you want. That'll just give some kind of information associated with your map. You can zoom in different places. You can change the map type. So there's road. Road is the basic view, the one that you're used to seeing like this. There's terrain, which is kind of a more 3D view like this. You'll see the geography of the mountains and the surrounding landscape. There's satellite, and satellite's the kind of really far away picture view like this. It shows the land and the water geography. And then there's hybrid, and that's sort of a combination of the ones we just went through. If that looks a little too realistic for you, then you don't have to do that. This is kind of like a satellite image hybrid. So I'm going to stick with road for now, keep it simple. Scroll wheel and touch drag. So when scroll wheel is checked, that means the user will be able to scroll over the map, and then instead of moving down the page once the mouse is over the map, it'll stop, and then you'll be able to scroll in and out of the map itself. So if we go to the live site, scroll wheel is on. When I'm scrolling down the page, it moves, but then when I get over to the map, you'll see how now I'm scrolling up and down, but it's zooming in and out of the map instead of scrolling up and down. If I turn that off, I would be able to scroll right past it and go all the way down. And there's also touch drag, which is similar, but that's for touchscreen devices. So if you were dragging your map on an iPhone of some sort, when your finger went over it, it would stay inside the map and keep moving it around. But if you don't want that to happen, you can turn touch drag off. So similar to the iframe, we can also change the sizing of this map. So you see how the map is right there, the element, and then there's the map div, which is a little bit taller. Of course, I'd want that to fill the whole space, so I can just change the height dimensions here, make that 100%. I could make the width half of this even. And then you could also add some flex properties, center the map if you really wanted, but I'd want it to take up the whole width here. And you can just affect the height and width however you want. You could even add a border technically to the map. You can add some green border. Say you want it to be 10 pixels thick. Not that pretty, but there's some ways to customize this. Again, you can do some overlays, hover effects, simple things. You don't want to be too distracting. And like I said before, you can't have too many things covering it because then you can't actually interact with the map. But really height and width is going to be the most important thing, especially when you are trying to scale down to different devices. Because on this device, so instead of side by side, say we'd want our content div to be flex vertical. And then since the map doesn't have any set height, it disappears for a second. But then we could just make the height 500 pixels. We would make the width 100 pixels instead. The info div would also be 100 pixels instead on this device. And then now the map takes up that full width. So there's ways to make it scalable for sure, and allow some flexibility. So this is the actual map element with the Google API connected. A little more customization options than the iframe embed that we did in the last section. So now let's walk through the pros and cons of these.
So the main difference between the API key and the iframe embed is that the API key is going to return an image object, while the iframe embed is going to return sort of a live representation link of the map in Google Maps. So the iframe embeds, they're definitely easier to implement, right? More user-friendly, all you have to do is copy and paste that link into your project. One con though is that it's going to result in some slower page load times because it is that live link, not an image. The good thing is that it's completely free. There's no usage limit, or it's not going to charge you for different map loads over time. And one more con is that you can't customize it too much. You're only allowed to affect the height, the width, and the border property, so it's not as flexible as the API key would be. So you're a little more limited here with the iframe. And looking at the API key, it will result in faster page load times because the API is returning that image object. It's not trying to pull a live map source. so the page will load a little bit faster. It's a little more complicated to implement because of all the different Google steps and going through that process. If you're not familiar with it, it could be a little tricky setting up the API key and linking it all together. So it's a little more difficult at the end of the day. But a good thing is that you can customize a little bit more. I showed you how to add some different terrain styles and the roadmap view. You can also go into your Google Cloud platform, and when you go down to map styles for this project, you'll see you have the ability to change the color settings. You can create a dark mode, you can make it Atlas, you can just change the kind of visual representation of it. So you definitely have more stylization flexibility with the API key. Another con though might be that you have to pay a fee after you go over the usage limit. So like I said, you really don't have to worry about this if you're using it for basic sites, but say you are running a giant company website where this is going to get a lot of traffic, you might have to pay for it over time. And depending on which map you're using, if there's a map that's more involved, that's showing routes between locations, street view options, it'll take more power to generate and it'll be more expensive over time. So I will say that even though the iFrame element is a little more straightforward and easy to implement by just copy and pasting, taking the time to set up the API key is probably the better option that you should go with. I say this for two reasons. One being that the client will definitely want faster page load times, right? So like I said, this is pulling an image object, so that'll make the page load faster when you're using the API key versus the embed element. Second, Google will rank your site higher if you use the API key. It's their own product, they're obviously gonna favor it, but the Googlebot and the crawler doesn't count iFrame content in the same way that it would if it were loaded onto your page through the API key. So if SEO and rankings for your web page is important to you, I will say you'll get a light boost from using the API key, so you'd probably go with that. But if you have a simple project and all you need is a Google map for quick reference, put the iFrame in there. It's not going to be a problem. Just use your judgment. Every project will be different. Don't worry about it too much. But in the meantime, go on an adventure. Find some inspiration for your next project. Because remember, this is our time.